أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين شفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين ولعنة الله الدائمة على أعدائه أجمعين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Now when we went to Qom for the first time after studying here, the first thing that appealed were those books and the glittery books. And the appeal was such, it was an obsession. As soon as we would get our shahriya, we would go and purchase one of these classical books that we have and the latest work of usul and the latest work of fit. Now the whole appeal there were the books in themselves. The colors, the binding, and the fact that I have Usul and Furu al-Kafi, Muhadarat of Sayyid al-Khoi. But the thing is, it was much later when the student begins to study and realize that actually that book doesn't have any value in there. It's the content therein that is valuable. And once we begin to understand the content, it doesn't really matter what shape or the form book comes in, because the book loses its appeal altogether when the content begins to show itself. When the aptitude is gained by a student to actually be able to understand the works of these great masters like Khoi, for example, in his fiqh and in his usul, you begin to see that actually I need to invest my money and my time in a lot of debates and not in purchasing books. But when does that happen? When the soul and the mind becomes ripe. But until then, the appeal is what? The beautiful books, possessing these books, starving, and that's literally what we used to do. We used to starve in order to purchase books. This is exactly what happens with us and our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, we cannot yearn but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a student buys those books, even though the allure is the book itself and the name of the book, but the real objective is the content inside the book. But because a student does not have the aptitude to appreciate the content inside the book, they are in a very accidental or an artificial way appreciating the book. But the thing of appreciation is what is inside the book. The content inside the book. The same story is true with me and you and our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our relationship with Allah, the only important thing is Allah. And for Allah, the only important thing is me and you. Everything else is a means to strengthen that bond and that relationship. It's not supposed to be an end within itself. So when we ask Allah for anything, indirectly we are asking Allah for Allah only. And when Allah gives us whatever we want, indirectly Allah is only giving Himself to us and nothing else. It cannot be other than this. It can never be other than this. Think about it. And think about it very, very carefully. When we said yesterday that me and you are quickly advancing towards our death, we will die. There is no doubt in that. If anybody has any doubt that they will die, dispel it right now. We will die. And me and you, especially us, of this age, are going to die much sooner than anybody else. So let us not be mistaken about that. Now, when me and you die, what are we going to take with us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or to the next life? You see, nothing will accompany us from this world. The only thing that will accompany us is us ourselves. Allah says, and shall fade away from them everything that they've called upon, and there they shall find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in another place Allah says that everything that they have amassed and towards which they are rushing will appear as a mirage. It will quickly fade away. And at that point they will find only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now in that next life, it's the life with Allah. The first thing we need to do is to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you ever wonder why we are so afraid of death? We are afraid of death, are we or are we not? We don't know what death is, we don't know what lies beyond death, because it's a frightening thing. The only reason why we fear death is because we don't have this connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In everything that we do, the great goal, who was supposed to be the goal, has been left out altogether. You see, I give £1,000 towards a mosque, thinking that that mosque will help me, and of course it will help me. But the benefit of that mosque is very accidental. Had I given one pence of it, through the recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I would have known that Allah is musabbibul asbab. He will create whatever He wants. But in that act of giving, I would have been connected with my Allah in a very essential manner. That one pence would have meant far more in that way than £1,000. When we are calling on to Allah, it's become a very accidental practice. I gave this example a few days ago. We'll give it again. You see, we read the Quran in the month of Ramadan and we have to complete it. Now that Quran has benefits for us, but those benefits are very accidental. They're not essential benefits, because we are not understanding the Quran. Now an Arab reads the Quran, who understands Arabic. His benefit is also accidental, because he does not go into the Quran for the sake of guidance. He only understands the meanings of the words. In fact, an Arab who knows Arabic should be in more of a dilemma than a person who doesn't understand Arabic, because they know what it is saying and still there is no guidance. So the thawab that comes in is very, very accidental. But if a person were to open the Quran and say, my God, the creator of the worlds has taken time to speak with me about the secrets of the whole world. If we went with that attitude, then that would be an essential benefit that we derive from the Quran. Nonetheless, there's an accidental benefit. This is what I'm saying. We give in charity. We do all these good things. But because that God connection is not there, it becomes accidental. To the extent that when I'm about to die, if I feel fear of death, and you come and tell me, you have given millions in the way of Allah, why should you be afraid of death? Allah will receive you. I will tell you, oh man, I have wasted millions in the name of Allah, the one that I have never known and never recognized. If I had truly done something in the name of Allah, then do you think I would be hesitating from dying right now? I would open my arms and say, oh angel of death, hasten. Wasn't that the case with the lovers of Hussein? Al-Habib was trembling and his head was in the lap of Hussein. He says, Habib, what brings a smile to your face? He says, this is your grandfather. He's saying, oh Hussein, hasten to me. Hasten to me. And as Hussein said at the grave of Imam, at the grave of the Prophet, he said, oh Prophet, allow them to take me right now. Why should I have to wait till Karbala? If my worship of Allah was truly centered on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I understood it, then at the point of death I would not feel fear, because I have already established the connection with one that I already know, not the one that I have to find after death. In fact, a dying person knows everything but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why we find this huge fear within our hearts of death. Allah cannot give anyone anything to us but Himself, because everything will perish other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doesn't Allah say in the Quran, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. Everything upon it will perish. Doesn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say that everything will perish? So if Allah were to give me something, what has He given me if it's going to perish? Nothing will stay with me. Think about it. Allah cannot give me anything but Himself. And I cannot ask from Allah anything but Himself. Now let's explain that a little. When I ask Allah for £1,000,000, why am I asking Allah for £1,000,000? Because I want to purchase a building for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if I know Allah properly, then I know that Allah is Musabbibul Asbab. He is the one who paves every part of cause and effect. Then I don't have to say, Allah, Allah, give me £1,000,000. I would just say to Allah, Allah, if you feel in your infinite knowledge, and if it is better, then make that building be for your cause, and Allah will do it. Why should I beg Him for £1,000,000? Have I ever thought about this? Two, if I ask Allah for £1,000,000 for myself, yes, then surely there is something wrong here with me. Because what will I ask for? £1,000,000 in order to eat, drink and have a roof over my head. Shouldn't I be thinking in a different way and saying to Allah, Allah, I am here with needs, you know my needs, cater for them. If we really read the Quran, we would come, and I want to discuss this afterwards, inshallah, of the vertical and the horizontal prayers. Look at the du'as of the Prophet. They said, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةَ حَسَنَا. They didn't say, حَسَنَا means £1,000,000 or £10,000,000, did they? They said, give us good in this world, because you know better than I do what is good. You know better than I do what is good. رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِمَنْ دَخَلَ بَيْتِيَ مُؤْمِنًا. This was the du'a. Look at the du'as these prophets have made. Beautiful du'as within the Quran. When have they ever specified anything? Now, whenever I ask for something, why am I asking? Because I feel there is a lack within me. And this lack can be fulfilled with the completion of this prayer. Otherwise, I wouldn't pray. If I didn't need £1,000,000, I wouldn't ask for £1,000,000, would I? If I didn't need a house, I wouldn't ask for a house. If I didn't need to pass my exams, I wouldn't beg Allah to make me pass my exams. But in all of those things that I've asked, what does it signify? It signifies that there is a state of lack within me. And the fulfillment of lack immediately is coming from £1,000,000, or a building, or a car, or passing of an exam, or saving of a person's life, or restoring of health. That's immediately in my mind. But what I fail to understand is that Allah is the wealth of all wealth. Allah is the health of all health. Allah is the life of all life. That is what I'm failing to understand. And what Allah is responding me with is a glimpse of His beautiful self through gold and silver. And that is why our masters say, O Lord, is it but You who is manifest in the face of Layla, in the glitter of the gold and silver, in the kingdom of this earth and the wealth and wealth and ending? It is nothing but Allah in all of this. So Allah grants us this little prayer so that we may awaken to this understanding that my God, He is the one who sustained Yunus within the belly of a fish. He is the one who sustained Khidr within the heavens. So that we may awaken at some point that He is the one who's been doing all of these things anyway. And if He gives me something that I ask for, He is only trying to awaken me that He is only giving me Himself. Allah never says in the Quran, as emphatically as He says, وَدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. He never says it as emphatically as this, قُلَّ عِبَادِي عَنِّي إِنِّي قَرِيبُ جِيبُ دَعْوَةَ دَاعِيَ إِذَا دَعَانِي. He has never said anything as emphatically as these two statements, that call me, I will respond. call me, I will respond, I am very, very near. He's trying to make us awake, awaken, understand the truth. The Prophet said, "An-nasu niyam in matu intabahu." The people are asleep, when they die, they awaken. On that day, Allah says, يَقُولُ الْإِنسَانِ يَا لَيْتَنِي قَدَّمْتُ لِحَيَاتِي. On that day, man will say, يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرَ الْإِنسَانِ يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرَ What is it? يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرَ الْإِنسَانِ وَأَنَّ لَهُ ذِكْرَ يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي قَدَّمْتُ لِحَيَاتِي. The day in which man becomes mindful, and to what avail is his becoming mindful on that day, when he shall exclaim and cry out, if only I had sent something for my life. What we are asking from Allah, if only we could understand, is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The answer is very simple. Ask Allah of Allah. He who has Allah is not left without anything. And he who doesn't have Allah doesn't have anything. So when Allah gives us anything, He is giving us a portion of His own beautiful self in order to awaken us. But the most beautiful gift that Allah can give us is to open this heart and mind to the fact that there has been nothing but Allah. Uthman bin Affan went to Ammar ibn Yasir. When Ammar ibn Yasir was beaten up on Uthman's instructions, yes? To relieve himself of the guilt. And when he beat up Ammar, had Ammar beaten up, Aisha gave that statement that killed Uthman. I'm not trying to inflame anything, I'm just narrating history, the historical context of this. So Uthman went under these pressures, yes? That one, Aisha said that I could speak ill of any Sahabi of the Rasulullah apart from Ammar. The Prophet has said Ammar is filled with Iman from the top of his head till the tip of his toes. Yes, and Aisha gave this statement. So Uthman immediately went to Hazrat Ammar. He said to Ammar, you're a poor man. I have come to give you gifts. And he brought a lot of wealth. Ammar said, when in my youth I needed all of this, you didn't give me a penny of it. Now when I'm about to die, what good is this wealth for me? He said, but your daughter is young. She will use it after you. He said, Uthman, the same Allah who has been looking after her throughout my life is more than capable of looking after her after my death. Look at the way Ammar has awoken to the truth. At mine and your age, this is not a plaything for us anymore. Me and you should not be thinking of increasing our capital to millions and billions and trillions. At mine and your age, we make the dua that the Prophet made. Oh Allah, give me satisfaction for whatever you have given me. Give me satisfaction for whatever you have given me. Oh Allah, let me thank you for whatever you have given me. Oh Allah, let me be patient for when you deprive me of a morsel. Oh Allah, let me be humble in front of you in every state. Oh Allah, lessen my burdens. This is the Prophet's prayer that we should be making at this age of ours. Not any other prayer. And the peak of all prayers is what? Oh Allah, be pleased with me. Because if you are pleased with me, then the displeasure of this world means nothing to me. And if you are displeased with me, oh Lord, then what can this world do for me? That is the prayer me and you should be making at this age. Because Allah has taught us enough that He has given us whatever we require for us to know that at this age now, and I want to work on this a bit more, that at this age now, we begin to open our eyes and our minds that we've only yearned Allah. At this age, when we go into sajda, we should find such beauty with our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we would want Allah to hide us away from all. At this age of ours, we would want to remain silent so that the heart is involved with our Allah and not in futile talk. At this age of ours, we should not be looking at others and how successful they are. We should be saying, Allah, thank you for making them so successful. And make their success a means for them to come to you. At this age of ours now, Allah should prevail upon our beings. So Allah only gives us Himself. And how He completes us is something we want to touch on in a little while. If not today, then tomorrow. How He completes us by giving us Himself. And the only thing Allah can give us is Himself. And the only thing we can yearn is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, think of these ahadith that we have been reciting and saying naras and naras and naras upon, but we have not had the time to contemplate upon them. What did the great master Ali ibn Abi Talib salamullah alayhi say? I two of his outstanding statements. I do not worship Allah, the worship of a slave who fears his wrath. I do not worship Allah, the worship of a businessman who yearns his paradise. I worship Allah as a free soul, for He is worthy of me humiliating myself in front of Him. After that, let Allah do what He wants with me. The other hadith, Ali does not worship a God that Ali does not see. Look at that. These are the sentiments that ought to prevail upon us. This is the place where we need to be at this point. When we get the glimpse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is when the true life begins. Rabi Adawiyah used to take a bucket of water with her, and they ask her, why have you taken the bucket of water? She says, to spill it upon the hell of Allah, to extinguish His fire, so that nobody worships Allah through His fear. And she cried out, O Lord, if I have worshipped You in fear of Your hell, burn me therein. And if I have worshipped You in the desire of Your paradise, then deny me of it. Look at this. Allah, if we were to understand Him, then we would know actually the true goal, what it is. Allah says to the people of paradise, by the way, in my own understanding, the human beings really don't have a clue as to what is happening. This self-importance that we have, we will go into our paradise and we will think, my God, we've achieved it. No, you haven't, and I and you haven't achieved it. Even in the seventh paradise, nobody's achieved it. My God, the mystery of Allah is so grand that even the great Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam cannot understand it. Even he can't understand it, the mystery of God. Do you know the hadith of Imam Sadiq salamullah alayhi? He said, after you have died, Allah will create another creation on the face of this earth much better than you, to cut us down and to put us into our place. You have just been a step ladder of evolution for others greater than you to come. Neither are you of any significance, neither are they. Allah's mystery and Allah's purpose is Allah's mystery and Allah's purpose unending. How foolish of me to not to awaken to this truth. Now, look at the way Allah teases the people of paradise. He puts them into paradise, they are rejoicing. And immediately Allah says, وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٍ. And we have more to offer. We have more to offer. Imagine. He will tease people even in paradise and keep their hearts yearning and open the veils again in paradise that look, you have still not arrived at God of all God. You see, if the creator of paradise can create a paradise that is so beautiful, I'll give an example. The glory of this world, the Layla of this world, the beauty of her face, the glitter of gold and silver, the diamonds and the gemstones, the great authority of Sulaiman, and the unending kingdom given to him above the jinn and man and beasts. All of this is not even a faint ray of the beauty of Jannah that Allah has created. If this Jannah is so alluring, if it is so tempting, that we do not find ourselves free of it, then imagine how beautiful the Creator must be. The Creator of this paradise must be. Imagine, if somebody is touched by that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, imagine the state of that person. By God, such a soul will say to Allah, O Lord, Your paradise is not enough of a reward for me. After tasting Your love, says Imam Zainul Abidin, O Lord, how will my heart rest for anything other than You? Or as he says again in Dua Abu Hamza Thumali, after knowing you, O God, if I am being burnt in the pits of hell, I shall cry out to those who burn me that I burn in the love of the one who is burning me here. Imagine those who have found him. Just a glimpse of him. Imagine if that Allah is found. And he's saying, Ud'uni astajib lakum. Call me, I will respond to you. Let us give further examples. A youth who is besotted with his Layla. And he wants Layla to reciprocate. But Layla is not reciprocating. And the youth is in the state of not knowing whether Layla feels the same for him as he does for his Layla. At that point, look at that youth. Examine him. When I say that youth, I'm asking you all to go back to those memories. Go back to those memories of teenagers. That youth does not know if his Layla feels the same way for him. You give clothes to the youth. The garments are worn by the youth, but in the mind is, how will my Layla perceive me in these garments? Is it not? You give him food. As he eats, his Layla in his mind accompanies him. Nothing means anything to him but his Layla. At that point, when Layla appears to him, and Layla smiles at him, acknowledging his love and reciprocating his love, grab that moment, seize that moment. Tell the youth, O youth, what is most important? Your clothes, your house, your wealth, your friends. What is most important for you at this point? Come with us. They are all calling you. He will say, I will sacrifice it all 1,000 times over for this moment for which I was waiting. That is the intensity of the reception of a worldly Layla. Imagine the intensity of the reception of the Lord of Layla. And how his love must be. My God! Is it any wonder that Muslim ibn Awsata says to Hussein that we will engage with your enemy with our swords. If they break, with our spears. If they break, we shall throw stones at them. If they seize, with bare hands. When they are cut, and if our heads are cut, and if our bodies are rendered into 1,000 pieces, if they are burnt after that, if we are scattered in thin air, by Allah, O Hussein, we will once again wish from Allah to restore us that we can hasten to you again and fight with your enemies once again. Is it any wonder that he said this? Because he felt that essence of love of Allah and that essence of love of the Prophet and his family. Imagine the pleasure that Muslim ibn Awsaja was in. If we could understand what is at stake, we would not ask from Allah, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nonetheless, dua of any type is good. Imam Khomeini quotes in his exegy this verse, Man kharaja min baytihi muhajiran illallah wa rasulihi. He who comes out of his house, migrating to Allah and his Prophet, and if death befalls him, then Allah is his reward. Then his reward is upon Allah. Imam Khomeini comments that Allah does not say that the paradise and the gardens are his reward. He doesn't say the huril-ain are his reward. Gold and silver, he says the reward is upon Allah. Because the paradise is too less for such a person as a reward. If somebody comes out of his heart and begins to travel to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if death befalls them, then Allah is his reward. And what about the hadith of Mi'raj? When Allah says to the Prophet, when such a soul, a pure soul is taken, before the blinking of an eye, he is brought to me. I ask of it, O soul, inform me of the affairs of the world. It trembles in my presence and says, O Lord, after recognizing you, I have but trembled in your awe. I know nothing of the inhabitants of the earth. Allah will say, you have spoken the truth, O righteous soul. I swear by my might and my glory, I shall keep you in a place where there is no veil between you and between me. not even the veil of Jannah, not even the veil of garden and Hurul Ain or anything else. Dua carries that deep meaning inside it, that I am yearning Allah only, and Allah is yearning me only. And whenever I ask for anything, Allah gives Himself to me. I'll finish with one last hadith, that the Prophet of Allah was in Sajidah outside the Kaaba before the conquest of Makkah and before the migration. His uncle threw the intestines of a camel upon him. The heavens trembled and Mikael descended. Mikael said, O Messenger of Allah, Allah cannot withstand this state of yours. Look above. There are armies of angels. Take their aid and destroy your enemies. And these are the keys to the treasures of the heavens. Take as much as you want and feed yourself, and Allah will still give you the reward that He has prepared for you at the end of your mission. You no longer need to starve. There were tears flooding from the eyes of Muhammad Rasulullah. As he said to Jibreel, as he said to Mikael, he said, take them all away, O Grand Messenger of Allah. On the day in which He gives me a morsel, I shall consume it and thank my Lord. On a day in which He deprives me my morsel, I shall endure and thank Him in patience. And he said, O Lord, do not give me the trust of my own affairs into my own hands, even for the blinking of an eye. Least having wealth distracts me from You. Allah la'natullah al-qawmi al-zalimin wa say'alamu al-lazina zalamu wa yamun qalami yanqalibun. إلهينا نسألك بحق الحسين وجده وأبيه وأمه وأخيه وتسعة المعصومين من ذريته وبنيه. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. اللهم عجل فرج إمامنا المنتظر واجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة.